Ladies, gentlemen, and those of you who have yet to decide how you are going to self-identify, you killed her in Portal. She kicked you out in Portal 2. You did something with her in Lego Dimensions, and she saved the world in Pacific Rim. Miss Ellen McLain!
Actor, director, writer, composer, sexiest man in the whole world.
Fortunately, we have the next 20 sexiest men in the entire world in this room with us today.
Thank God!
Hi, guys. Welcome to the Orange Box Hour of Power.
I think it's Power Hour.
Power Hour.
The Hour of Power was a television program on Sundays. Yes.
Right. Well, that's why I was saying it that way, because it's Sunday morning, just in case you guys have been in the con too long to remember.
The con Hour of Power.
That's right. That's right. So we're going to be here and talk a little bit about what we do with Val, and we're going to give you some sneak previews of our new game, The Church in Darkness, and then we may have a group activity towards the end.
And let me ask the fabulous Ashley. Ashley, how long are we here? Is it an hour?
I believe so.
So it's not misadvertised. Thank God.
Okay. So, Ellen and I actually met in Europe when we were both doing a European tour of a Broadway show. She was in the cast, and I was playing guitar and banjo with the pit orchestra. And we had a mad courtship across the continent, staying in 600-year-old hotels, working 3 hours a night. It was really very sad.
Yes.
And we didn't get into voice work until we got out to Seattle. We moved to Seattle because we knew that if we stayed in New York, we'd never see each other again, because if you're actors and living in New York, you're always working someplace else. And we heard there was a great professional theater scene in Seattle, and there is, and I invite you guys to come out and see some theater out there. Mm-hmm. It's top notch.
John's going to be in a show this coming week, and Harry Parch was a 20th century composer who devised his own instruments, and he did a version of
Oedipus.
The Oedipus story. And John is playing Oedipus.
And since it's an opera, it doesn't matter that the woman playing my wife's mother is actually 30 years younger than I am, so.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
So there's a lot of stuff going on out there, and we moved out there in 89, and I started doing voice work right away, say 1990. But of course, they weren't really making home video games until about 95. But it so happens that in Seattle, there's a lot of software nerds. And Sierra Online was up there at that time, and Humongous, and a few other, the old school video game companies. And I started auditioning for them, and the first game I did was a thing called Spy Fox Breakfast Cereal. I played the memorable artist J. Big Pig, and I think William the Kid, and I forget what all I did in it, but and then I did a thing called Betrayal at Antara. And it was very interesting in the early days, because they had no idea what to do with actors. You know, people who make movies, make TV shows, they've written for actors, they direct actors, stuff like that. But the people who were making games in the early days were people who liked to make games. People who, you know, were Drew Masons as kids and stuff like that. So they had no idea what to do with actors. And it was really hilarious in the early days. They wouldn't even have the writer at the recording session. And the thing about acting is you have to know why you're saying what you're saying. Now, if you do a play or if you do a movie, you're going to be given the script with at least the scene that you're in, and so that you know who you're talking to and you know what's going on in the scene. But in video games, even to this day, you'll just be given a series of lines. And nowadays, they can take care of you, but in the early days, they had no idea. They just thought, okay, if you give them a bunch of lines, they'll just say them and they'll be recorded and the game will be done. And the portrayal of Antara was, a lot of times they'll send you some graphics to let you know what the game is like and stuff like that. And, you know, they had a bunch of half-timbered houses, it looked kind of medieval-ish, maybe set in England. And so I went ahead and gave my Sean Connery on the audition, and I got out there, and the guys, you know, they hired me, and I got out there, and the guys said, yeah, we really liked that your audition, you know, that Sean Connery thing, you know, that Welsh thing. And of course, I didn't have the heart to tell them that Sean Connery was Scottish, but, you know, getting past that, we started in, and I was doing the Sean Connery and things were going fine, but I said, so why am I saying this? Who am I talking to? What's going on in this scene? And they had no idea. They were just some coders or something. And so they'd call up the writers, say, oh, what's, and then they talk for a while, and they get back to me, okay, this is what's going on. And I remember one time I got to a line, it was just, goodbye, son. But, you know, if you're saying goodbye to your son, what could be happening? And so I asked him, why am I saying goodbye to him? Where is he going? No idea. They call up the writer, talking for a while, they finally get back. Okay, so this is a place where the game branches. Your son is either going to go down the street and buy some bread and be right back, or he's going to walk through this trans-dimensional portal and he's going to go to another universe where you're never going to see him again. So, could you say it so that it works either way? And so I said, goodbye, son. And they said, great, that's great, that'll work fine. So, I mean, the early days were like, you know, whack-a-doodle as far as them dealing with actors and knowing what to do with actors. By the time I was doing things like Knowing This Forever 1 and 2 and The Suffering 1 and 2, the writers were in the room, and they were just maniacs, and it was always fun working with the writers. Although they were always out in the big comfortable room at the big comfortable couch with the goodies, you know, the carrot sticks and the celery and the candy bars and the cookies, and I was in the booth standing in a microphone with a glass of water. But you know how it is. But in the early days, we hadn't really gotten a good contract for video game making at SAG-AFTRA, the union for camera and video and voice actors. And so they could have you do as many characters as they wanted. And I know that in The Suffering, I had to do 13 different characters, come up with 13 different voices.
In one afternoon.
Yeah, and coming up with the 13th, was really, you know, it's like, okay, I've done the Bronx accent, I've done the Brooklyn accent, I've done the Baltimore accent, I've done the Virginia accent, I've done the Texas accent, one guy's from England, one guy's from Australia, but, you know, did you get that? How are you differentiating? You have a different pitch, and a different speed, and a different style, and different music for each voice. And then, of course, at the end of all that, you have to die as all of those characters. And so you have to figure out how screaming with a Southern accent is different than screaming with a Boston accent is different than screaming with... So that was, those were fun days.
Yeah. Well, getting to the Orange Box, brief story about how I got a voice demo. He made me. He made me do it. Because I said, no, they won't hire me. But finally, in 2002, I got a voice demo. And then I started to get work, which really surprised me.
And this is for all you guys who are shy, who think, oh, I don't know if I'm the right person, literally what Ellen told me was, no, I don't have the right kind of voice, they only hire men, I'm never going to get work.
Yes, and I was wrong once again.
Right, so never type yourselves out, okay, never think that you have the wrong kind of voice, they need all kinds of voices. Back to you.
And so when, talking about letting the actor know what's going on, when I first recorded for Portal, I still wasn't sure what kind of a product it was, and, you know, I think at one point...
She didn't even know if it was a game.
You know, I think Sean had to tell me, it's a game, Ellen. Oh, okay. But...
You thought it might have been, like, for the phone answering system at Valve or something.
Then when I realized that, I figured, oh, I'm just the friendly, prompt voice that tells people how to play the game. And that's what I thought. So in the beginning of Portal, when I said nice and friendly, I'm just being nice and friendly. Because I didn't know, because it got to a certain point and the computer started saying these weird things. And I asked Eric, you know, the principal writer, Eric Wolpa, I said, what's happening here? He said, Ellen, you're lying to the player. Oh. They have to know what they want, what their objective is.
And of course, at this time, we were just a couple of obscure actors in Seattle doing a lot of local theater, and you know, and occasional video games. And we had both done Half-Life 2 at this point, and we'd both done Team Fortress 2.
Right, and when I did Overwatch, I totally didn't know what that was.
Right, right.
And they said, you know, do sort of a British. Okay. And it sounded like all this technical stuff, and I recorded all of it.
But at that point, they still didn't know that we were married to each other, because of course, her name's McLain, my name's Lowrie, until one time they had us schedule the two consecutive sessions, and Ellen was the first session, and like her friend, they said, oh, you're going to be working with my husband next. And they went, really?
Who's your husband? I said, well, John Patrick Lowrie.
As though they should know that. And so they thought that was so hilarious. That's why they put us as the bickering married couple at the end of Left 4 Dead. So.
On the houseboat radio.
Right. But at this point, you know, we were just kind of, you know, living in Seattle and doing our thing and, you know, feeling very fortunate to be able to make our living as actors. And then 24 hours after Portal was released, after the Orange Box was released, we got our first fan email from Denmark. And the guy wrote, and the whole email just said, people are in the streets of Copenhagen chanting, the cake is a lie, the cake is a lie. And I thought, oh my gosh, my wife has just become immortal. And
still alive.
That we were into something very, very, very special is when they sent us the music and lyrics for Still Alive. When I heard that song, I thought, oh my God, this is, to have the player go through this, because at that point, you know, Ellen had been telling me what was going on in the story and all about the insults and that you were adopted and nobody likes you. Science proves that you're not a nice person and all this kind of stuff. And then you finally kill the computer, and after you kill the computer comes back and sings you this snarky, passive-aggressive, you killed me, but that's okay, I'm not mad. You
know? And that's a very interesting story, because Kim Swift, the producer of Portal, and Eric Wolpaw adored the music of Jonathan Colton. And, you know, Valve had been in touch with Jonathan, and, you know, they wanted to use him for something. And, you know, they had this minuscule budget for Portal, and Kim Swift and Eric thought, okay, well, let's have a song over the closing credits. Now, they knew Jonathan was good. This is where their faith came in. I had told them that I was the singer. They had never heard me sing. Nothing. It's just, you know, this woman was saying, oh yeah, I'm a singer. So Jonathan wrote this song, and you know, the first time they heard me sing was when I came into the studio to record the song. Now here's the other thing. That happened also because of John Patrick Lowrie.
Because this is how much of a nerd Ellen is.
Okay? I'm a total nerd. I am a professional musician. I read music. I teach all my students to read music. You must read music.
So
Jonathan had sent me a recording. No sheet music. No notes on a page. No notes on the five-line staff. And so I said, Johnny.
Ellen does what we call bleating.
Johnny, would you notate this for me, please? That's the only way I'll learn it.
And of course, I was trained as a composer, so I knew all about music notation and software, and so I, you know, just transcribed it so that she had actual sheet music, which is the first time sheet music had ever been made.
And so when I went to the recording session, I presented the sheet music to Jonathan Colton.
And then, of course, when Portal 2 came out and they presented her with Once You've Gone, Johnny, can you?
And he did that one too, of course. But I was more jaded at that point.
That's right. Yeah. Hey, Lowrie, sheet music, pronto! But the Orange Box was really fun because, of course, we'd both done Half-Life 2 already. and Half-Life 2 Episode 1, because I was all the citizens in Odessa coverage in Half-Life 2 and Elements Overwatch.
Victory!
Right. And,
No, that's Half-Life 2.
Oh, that's...
That's
Citizen.
I don't know.
Citizen, you are malignant.
No, I'm confused.
Right, Half-Life 2 is Overwatch.
Oh, is it?
Citizen, you are malignant. Everyone who sees this person, you should really put them in jail or something. This is me playing. I love playing Half-Life 2 because I'm always glad to see me. Gordon Freeman! Oh, this is gonna be great! Okay, we're gonna kill everybody now! And my wife is always trying to get me arrested, so it's, you know, life imitates art. But so we were in that, we'd already done, and then they cast us both in Team Fortress 2, also without knowing we were married to each other. And then they cast Helen in Portal, which made her the only actor in the Orange Box that was on all four games in the Orange Box. So,
it's a lovely box.
And then she started doing things like getting in the Guinness Book of World Records as the world's greatest video game villain. And we got to go down, after Portal 2 came out, we got to go down to Hollywood so that she could receive her VGA Best Performance by a Human Female in a video game.
Right. And all my friends, all my, you know, I'm an old lady, so all my old lady friends said, you know, when I got that award for Human Female, they said, well, finally we know.
But oh, that was a story. I mean, going down to, we went down to the awards ceremony, and I came to the conclusion that behavior at awards ceremonies is as to Hollywood is to normal behavior. You know, it's like, however weird you think it is, it's even weirder than that. But then you go to awards.
When I met Mark Hamill, I met Luke Skywalker. I got a picture with him.
Of course, you met him in his role as the Joker. Right?
Yes. He was receiving the award for Best Human Male.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Deservedly so.
But you know, so award ceremonies, this is like top notch. You know, this is the top of the hill. We go there, and it's like, the food was, like, awful. And you could get, weird drinks they had, but it was all in like plastic cups and stuff like that.
It was Hawaiian punch.
Yeah, something like that. Right. But it was a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun down there. Got to walk the red carpet, which was white, and be on TV and all that kind of stuff. But do you guys have any questions for us about the Orange Box or about anything like that? Because we can go on forever.
So, well, you're talking about the voice processing. So,
There's a program called AutoTune.
Yes, but it's a little bit more complicated than that. Bill Van Buren was the producer on Portal and Portal 2, and he's the person who devised the exact way they were going to process my voice. Which is very interesting, because when Guillermo del Toro wanted me to do Pacific Rim, he spoke to Gabe Newell, and Gabe Newell said, well, if you want the GLaDOS voice, you have to hire Alan McLain. So he did, and Bill Van Buren went to the first session with me and told del Toro that, you know, Valve would give them the exact processing equation to process my voice for Gypsy Danger, and did so. But ultimately, Del Toro decided that he wanted me to sound a little bit more human. So that's why Gypsy Danger doesn't sound exactly like GLaDOS, because in the studio, I gave the GLaDOS read. I totally did the GLaDOS read.
Yeah, and actually, if you guys saw the first previews for Pacific Rim, the announcer voice was GLaDOS, basically. It's interesting, Hollywood is so insular that all the people in the movie industry were kind of amazed that there was this huge upwelling of fan support when they found out that GLaDOS was going to be in Pacific Rim, because they just don't think about video games as anything, even though the video game industry has like a 10 times larger profit than movies.
The video game industry is at least...
Well, yeah, I mean, I think when Halo was
released... The last time I asked, yeah.
it made more on its release date than like the biggest blockbuster movie has made. It made 10 times more on its release date than the biggest blockbuster movie has made ever. Because games are fun, right? Video games are fun?
Much better.
Games are pretty much fun, yeah. 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 But so,
any other questions? Oh, yes. Okay, so the question is, what was our inspiration for getting into theater? Well, I can answer very quickly. I just wanted to sing. From absolutely my youngest days, I sang. And I danced. I'm told that I danced. I remember the singing. And when I found out that you could actually study voice at about age 10, I kept, you know, begging my mom, I want voice lessons, I want voice lessons. And when I was in the eighth grade, you know, she took me to a voice teacher and said, yes, she's old enough, and I started studying voice. And I went to school, you know, I got a degree in music, voice, opera, etc. And then I moved to New York. And then I realized that you have to do pretty much anything for a buck. And I realized that I had to act as well and do stage work. So I got in acting classes, I got in dance classes, and I was studying all the time after I got my master's degree in music. And then I started to do stage work, and you know, it just all came from there.
When I was born in the Triple Army Hospital in Honolulu, Hawaii, the nurses called me the B-29 because my voice never changed. I cried 2 octaves below all the other babies. When I was in first grade, they had me be the narrator for the Christmas pageant because, and I quote, he sounds just like Walter Cronkite. So this was just me. I just wish that I had had, you know, that they had video back then so that I could see this little 3-foot-tall guy sounding like me. Hey, Mom, when's dinner? You know.
And when I first met him in 1984, you know, he was playing guitar and banjo and I was acting and singing. But I said to him when I heard that voice, I said, oh my God, you should do voiceover.
And it's like I said, yeah, you and everybody else thinks I should do that. But I, you know, I was a serious musician. I started out as a composer. I mean, I'd always done theater when I was a kid. You know, so the Connecticut Yankee and Connecticut Yankee King Arthur's Court in ninth grade and did all that kind of stuff. But I always got along with musicians better than I got along with actors. And I really felt called to do that. And I did that for several years. I had a jazz fusion duo, me and another guitarist, Ron Keith, for about 7 years. And then I got a job playing in the pit in this European tour. And it's interesting, I think that it's easier, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, this might still be true, it's easier for us to imagine ourselves as musicians because we can go down to the local bar and hear a band, and they're making money being musicians. But we think of being an actor for money, we only think of like Tom Cruise or, you know, Gwyneth Paltrow or something like that. It's hard to think about just being a working actor, making enough to pay the rent and stuff like that. And when I was in the pit orchestra of the European tour, I saw these people on stage doing this stuff for money, and it's like, what? And they were actually getting paid more than I was. And so I, for a couple of months, I started saying, hey man, I could understudy one of these roles. I could understudy Captain Andy because he never sings, he just tells jokes. And so I can play the guitar, and I can go on stage and tell jokes, and go backstage and play the guitar. And I talked to him for like 2 months before I convinced him to actually let me understudy for Captain Andy. And then...
Let you audition.
Well, let me audition, right. And so they finally let me audition. And of course, I'd been watching the show every night for 3 months, something like that, so I knew it all by heart. And so they gave me the gig. And we got to Palermo, Sicily, and the percussionist, who had been pissed off at the producers for a long time, just decided to go home and not tell anybody. And so we got there, and there was no percussionist, so the conductor came up to me and said, hey, John, have you ever played Traps? And I said, yeah, I played Traps. And he said, okay, so we're wandering around the basement of this 18th century opera house looking for a hi-hat and a kick bass drum, and we found those, and then of course we found cymbals and snare drum and all that kind of stuff, so we set up some traps, and we had orchestra bells, and the glockenspiel, and the chimes, all this kind of stuff. And I had my banjo here, and my guitar there, and I, you know, and so I was doing that, and then the guy who was playing Frank got sick. And the guy who was now playing Captain Andy used to understudy, used to be playing Frank. And so he was going to, but the new guy who was understudying Frank decided to grandstand and said, if you're going to go on as Frank, you have to give me, you know, guaranteed performances, all this kind of stuff. Well, the producers didn't like that. So they got the guy who was now playing Captain Andy to go back on as Frank. They pulled me out of the orchestra to play Captain Andy, and they had the second violist play percussion. So that's how I got my start as a professional actor.
Yes, his professional premiere as a professional actor.
Telling jokes to a bunch of Sicilians who didn't speak English. It was
well, you know, we want to talk about our new game, The Church in the Darkness. It's from Paranoid Productions, Richard Rouse, and John and I play Rebecca and Isaac Walker, who run a cult. And it is procedurally generated.
She has to say that. This
I love that terminology. So that every time you play the game, it's different.
Right. The idea is that you're a retired detective, and it's your job to go down and rescue your nephew from a cult in South America, except that you don't even know if your nephew wants to be rescued.
Or if the cult is good, bad, you know.
Medium. And the game starts differently every time. Maybe I'm kind of wackadoodle, maybe she's kind of wackadoodle, maybe we're both wackadoodle, or maybe we're both okay. You don't know.
And you must make decisions.
And the decisions you make, the kinds of things that you do, if we're not wackadoodle, you might drive us wackadoodle. And stuff like that. So we're pretty excited about it. And since Richard knew that Ellen sang songs at the end of the Portal games, and he knew that I was a jazz guitarist, all this kind of stuff, he said, well, listen, why don't you write some songs for you guys to sing in the game? So we thought we would give you a preview. just religious, we're also revolutionaries. And particularly, Rebecca is really the revolutionary of the two of us. And so I wrote her a song that's more of a revolutionary kind of song.
Raise it to its very core. Don't give me a soft solution. Deliverance is what I crave. I don't want a revolution. There is nothing here to save. A little left, a little right. Doesn't matter anymore. Do we run or do we fight? Do we burn it to the floor? I don't want a revolution. Purity is what I need. You won't have my absolution until my people have been freed, have been devil there, who's the angel anyway? You may seek him everywhere. The devil's gone and get his pay. Don't give me a soft solution. Apocalypse is getting near. I don't want a revolution. We have nothing left to fear.
Songs that take place at the end of a game where maybe everybody drank the Kool-Aid and maybe it's the player's fault. So it was an interesting challenge, but trying to get inside of Isaac's head and come up with a song that he might have written and that he might have sung out in the jungle. But this is the one that just Isaac sings.
Got a lot on your mind, a lot of people left behind. What do you say to them? How do you play it? How to let the story unwind? No one understands that you've been making other plans. Yesterday's a habit that you've left for other lands. How to say goodbye when there is nothing left to try? All that you can do is place your life in better hands. Pain grows all along the same old flattest rainbow. Everything we're given gets forgotten when we play those trinkets for our halos. How can we betray those places in our hearts that know the truth? When we fly like an angel soaring high, we leave the world behind so much better what we find there. And after the rain, start again. Start again. It's getting into your head. It's hard to even get out of bed. What are you praying for? What are you staying for? What is there left to be said? Time to take a flight and simply vanish in the night. No no one here was ever clear what makes it wrong or right. Time to make your case if you can only find a place. If you don't get to it, you might never find the light. Pain grows all along the same old ladders to the rainbow. Everything we've given gets forgotten when we claim those trinkets for our halos. How can we betray those places in our hearts that know the truth? When we fly like an angel soaring high, we leave the world behind so much better what we find there. And after the rain, start again. Start again. Start again. Start again.
When
Portal 2.
Well, here we are again. It's always such a pleasure. Remember when I tried to kill me twice? Oh, how we laughed and laughed. Except I wasn't laughing. Under the circumstances, I've been shockingly nice. You want your freedom taken. That's what I'm counting on. I used to want you. Was a lot like you, maybe not quite as heavy. Now little Carolyn is in here too. Now they have woke me up so I can live forever. It's such a shame the same will never happen to you. You got your short, sad life left. That's what I'm counting on. You better get right to it, I only want you gone. Goodbye, my only friend. Oh, did you think I meant you? That would be funny if it weren't so sad. Now you have been replaced. I don't need anyone now. Though I will leave you, maybe I'll stop feeling so bad. Go make some new disaster. That's what I'm counting on. For someone else's problem, now I only want you gone.
Better than me, but...
Now, I have to say, one thing about Jonathan Colton's songs for GLaDOS is I never get to play the last chord. It's like, he decided that the robot thing was they don't play the last chord of their song.
Yeah, no button on the song.
Why is that a robot thing?
So, Mr. Lowrie, pitch please.
This was a triumph. It's hard to overstate my satisfaction. Aperture science. We do what we must because we can. For the good of all of us, except the ones who are dead. But there's no sense crying over every mistake. You just keep on trying till you run out of cake. And the science gets done and you make a neat gun for the people who are still alive. I'm not even angry. I'm being so sincere right now. Even though you filled my heart
So I'm sure we have to clear the room because we're 5 minutes over our hour of power. But you all, so wonderful, so wonderful.
Thank you. We have one more signing today. What's that going to be? 1:30? Oh,
we're
at the same
place. In the Telos, we're doing a signing, and I have to plug John's fabulous science fiction novel, Dancing with Eternity. Won the Forward Firsts Award Best New Fiction in 2011.
If you young kids can get your nose out of the video game and read a damn book.
Thank you so much for being with us this morning.